I'm on the road to Baku, Azerbaijan, and then north to the ancient Silk Road along the Russian frontier. This is the vast Caspian Sea basin with abundant energy riches that can be piped to the European markets for the balance of this century. Scala, a leading digital technology company, celebrates the opening of the Central Asian populations to growth and prosperity. And Azerbaijan is leading the region in the development of a knowledge economy that depends upon digital tools for success.
I'm speaking with Sean Parnell. His new book, is Outlaw Platoon. He writes it with his colleague John R. Bruning, Heroes, Renegades, Infidels, and the Brotherhood of War in Afghanistan. These are two firefights lost in the fog of war these last years in Afghanistan. They took place in 2006 when, as Sean says, the effort for the United States, the challenge was in Iraq, not in Afghanistan. But the two firefights that Sean has gone through and survived with his platoon, thanks to a deal of luck and very disciplined behavior by his platoon and Sean, these two firefights evidence that the enemy is first-rate in Afghanistan. Flag that, first-rate. These are not rascals. They didn't just show up yesterday. They're not shooting old weapons. They're trained like the 10th Mountain. They're trained with air support, heavy weapons support and communications. They have the same and better because the mountains have ears. Now, let's go back inside the wire. Sean, you go back to FOB Barmel. I think I have the sequence correct that day. There are several of your men that are wounded, badly wounded, and you're badly wounded. And you're looked at cursorily by a physician's assistant. She does not do her job. Your captain comes in and stands up for you. But here's the point, Sean. You're asked to go back out again, and none of you put yourself on sick leave. None of you step out of combat. Why not?
Well, I mean, I think we didn't want to let each other down. We loved each other, and that's really what pushed us to do these sort of extraordinary things, I think. And it wasn't because bottom line is because we loved each other. We didn't want to let each other down, and we knew that if we left, they would have evacuated us out of country, and we would have been back in the States not supporting the mission or our brothers in Afghanistan.
You couldn't break contact, though you knew the Army would have filled your positions with new troops. There would have been new guys there within, what, a week?
I think at that time, probably a couple weeks, a month at the latest, they would have had replacement soldiers there, you know. But for me, I had, you know, me personally, I trained with these guys for a year and a half leading up to that, and at that point, like 6 months in combat, and I couldn't bring myself to leave them. I couldn't bring myself to put them under a brand new lieutenant, you know?
Your physician tells you you have the signals of post-concussive disorder. That's the pink stuff coming out of your ears. What are your symptomology? Because it's July now. You're back out. You're with the lieutenant colonel from Special Forces. Can you hear out of both ears, Sean?
No. For about the first 6 weeks, I couldn't hear out of my right ear. It was constant ringing. To be honest with you, I still have the ringing in my ears to this day.
Right.
But what had happened was is that pink stuff was cerebral spinal fluid. I had a couple of hairline fractures in my skull and was leaking the cerebral spinal fluid from my head, from my nose and my ears. And after a couple of weeks, that stopped. But the ringing in my ears didn't. I would have blurred vision every now and again. And for the first 10 days, I had about the worst headache that you could possibly imagine.
One of your men had shrapnel in his arm, and it scabbed over, and he didn't get it treated.
Yeah, right. I mean, he didn't even get it treated until 3 years after he had gotten back. I think of the 24 men that I had on the ground that day on June 10th, we were attacked by like 150, but 12 or 13 of them had shrapnel embedded in their arms, and it was just arms, legs, you name it. And it just was deemed when we were in Afghanistan, it's like, well, doing the surgery, the microsurgery to take that stuff out would be more damaging to the body than to just leave it in. And so here my guys would, you know, we were all back from Afghanistan and a couple of years later and they're having the stuff removed from them. So yeah, none of them had that stuff removed when we were there.
You go back out in July, you've learned a deal. One of the things you've learned is there's no such thing as too much ammo.
That's right.
And you you stock as much ammo as you can in your trucks. Also, the enemy has learned because Galang, you hear, has been wounded. What happens to him?
We ended up shooting him in the leg, and he was medically evacuated from the battlefield that day to a hospital in Wana, Pakistan, where they then amputated his leg. We didn't hear anything from him from that time on. We didn't even hear his call sign on the radio for the rest of the entire deployment. So we knew we had dealt a serious blow to the enemy at that point, but we didn't hear what his fate was after he had his leg amputated.
One more detail before I bring you back. You have a Special Forces unit that's not seen this much action since Colombia. This is early. Special Forces has now seen a lot of action everywhere. And they ride out with you that day, and you take them to a place called the Alamo, which is an old FOB or an old fort that's been abandoned next to another FOB. And you're rocketed that day. Stuff coming in from Pakistan. Who's got the 107-millimeter rockets? Who are those guys?
It was the PACMIL. So the Alamo is an Afghan National Army base that is directly across from a PACMIL base. They're probably, it's like a kilometer apart from one another in a town called Angorada. And it's, so we are getting rocketed. The moment we arrive at the Alamo, we are getting rocketed from Pakistan. And what the enemy is doing is they are among the PACMIL soldiers rocketing us amongst the PACMIL soldiers, knowing that we could not shoot back without causing an international incident. And all we could do was get down undercover behind HESCO walls, concrete barriers or whatever, and just wait for the indirect fire attack to end.
I want to fix this, Sean. This is July 2006. And you are being rocketed from Pakistan, from a Pakistan military base. They're using 107-millimeter rockets. I think those are Soviets. Is that correct? Those are Russian.
That's correct. That's correct.
And they've got you pinned. They know the range. They're hitting very close. The only thing that they don't know is exactly what hole you're in. And you call for air, you call for the 105-millimeter help, and they won't give it to you because the word is we can't shoot into Pakistan. Is that all correct?
That's right. We even had an Apache flying over our heads that could not shoot back because they would not fire into Pakistan. Or firing into Pakistan would harm PACMIL soldiers, which would be devastating to the war effort, which might cause an international incident between the United States and Pakistan. And, you know, it was devastating to have to live through, because here was a time where you survived through May 7th, you survived through June 10th, and here's a time where you're helpless. You're totally helpless. You can't shoot back at all, and you're just waiting for it to end. It was miserable.
Outlaw Platoon is the book. Sean Parnell of the 10th Mountain, who is now a veteran of Afghanistan. He works with bootcampaign.com. There's a website. It's about returning veterans. This book is as fierce a battle you'll ever read. I've never read anything more fierce, even World War II stuff. I'm John Batchelor. This is the John Batchelor Show.